Now on the World Service of the BBC Sports International, where Ed Herry is going to the dogs.
Welcome to Walthamstow Stadium in London's East End for Going to the Dogs, a look at greyhound racing. It's a sport which in the last 80 years has spread from places like this and is now found all over the world.
The first time we met, you were a kennel maid. You gave me a tip, I got me full calves paid. You were holding the greyhound in trap number one. Your white coat was shining in the afternoon sun. Now we're both together. We're never gonna break apart, no, no. 'Cause we're a happy couple, you and me. With a greyhound at either knee.
Well, I'm joined by Philip Chandler, whose family own and operate the Walthamstow track. First of all, Philip, for people unfamiliar with the sport of greyhound racing, what sorts of things will they see here on a race night? If you can just set the scene for us a bit.
Well, they'll see different racing over different distances. I mean, we'll have racing over hurdles, and tonight you'll have some heats for a big race that's coming up over the next few weeks.
Attendance-wise, there seem to be a lot of people here. How does greyhound racing compare with other spectator sports, to your knowledge?
It's the second largest spectator sport in England, second to football. I think the attendances at greyhound racing is probably about twice as much as horse racing.
And I've seen some of the publicity, the racecourse of the millennium, the finest in Europe. What sorts of things have made Walthamstow like that? And who said that about you as well?
Well, that was the Greyhound Association. I think the things that make Walthamstow special, I mean, are the fact that every year we refurbish one part of the building. And I mean, quite honestly, it's never ending. As we finish one bar, we go round the stadium, and by the time we finish, it's time to start again. I mean, everything here is, if you've been round, everything here is new, everything's air conditioned, all the restaurants are, all the bars are. You know, we just sort of just follow the latest trends.
Now, I suppose the stereotypical punter is in his flat cap and standing right by the finish line, but...
Not anymore, actually. No, not anymore. I mean, stereo punters, our type of punters, are a lot of city people. I mean, there are six corporate boxes here that are all fully booked for the next 3 months, and they're all city firms, all stockbrokers, money brokers. Corporate entertaining here is, in fact, I think it's probably our biggest earner.
I suppose part of it is that you don't need your flat cap and your big coat if you can go inside in the warm.
Exactly. I mean, the flat cap image of greyhound racing was when the stadium was built in the 30s. I mean, that's long gone.
Now, you mentioned the early years of the stadium there, that the Chandler family has been linked with this track for many, many years. Just give us an indication of how the family and the track are linked together.
Well, my grandfather was a bookmaker, and he built Walthamstow it opened in 1933, and it's been run by the family ever since.
It seems on nights like this we're seeing the sport at its best, but over the years, have there been lows? Have there been things the sport's had to bounce back from and learn from?
Yes, I mean, I think, I'm going back years, but I mean, obviously television, I mean, in the 30s and the 40s, we used to have crowds here of, I think our record crowd was something like 24,000. I mean, these days, I mean, a big crowd would be five. But I mean, television obviously won. I think video shops when they opened up, a little bit of an effect. The National Lottery when it started, had a bit of an effect for few months, but we weather all the storms, but at the moment it is reasonably a boom time. I mean, it's greyhound racing is doing very, very well.
For you, what's the future of Walthamstow Stadium, and what's the future of the sport? What do you see on the horizon?
Well, I think the sport has become more and more sort of catering orientated. I mean, years ago, 90% of the company's profits were from gambling. Today, 50% of the profits are for gambling and 50% are catering. In fact, probably catering slightly more than the gambling now. And that is that's the thing of the future. I mean, people do say we are the biggest pub in Essex, and I think that's true. I think we're the biggest outlet of spirits in Essex.
There was nothing in my life bigger than beer.
Remember some of your biggest wins?
No. I don't generally win that much because we bring the children and they tend to be very small bet. Hold them and don't lose them.
How is it as a family night out then? What sort of things can you do?
Oh, we just pick the dogs together, don't we, Aaron? And have little bets on them and go and have a drink. They get excited. We get excited for them. Yeah, they enjoy it.
We're not playing for big money, I don't think, but it's kind of a satisfaction of the smugness of picking a winner, which I've singularly failed to do so far. My friend here is a fiver up, so he's looking very smug. But no, it's good fun. You're betting a couple of pounds on each race, so it's not really serious gambling. It's just a kind of makes a change from going down the pub, really. I suppose it's a bit of a different place to go to.
I can see you just want some money.
Yeah.
Very well done.
Thank you.
Apart from the money, what do you like about coming down to the dogs?
I don't know. It's the first time I've come and bet.
Is that the first bet you've ever had?
Yeah.
And how much did you win?
£7.
Well done. Would you be placing more bets?
Oh, definitely.
Do you think you've got the winning habit?
No, I don't think so.
did you find it exciting there watching the race?
Yes, definitely. Very much so.
Why do you think it's taken you so long to find the place? Would you usually be doing something else on a Saturday night?
Yes, probably going out drinking. But my friends let me know about this, so I decided to come. But I wouldn't have come had they not told me about it.
Start with you, sir. What's the fascination for you coming down to the Greyhound track?
I don't know, it's just the atmosphere, I think. Everyone's happy, everyone's laughing, shouting. It's just a great atmosphere.
And have you been coming here for a long time?
No, it's only the second time we've been, and, really enjoyed it.
What's attracted you? Who sort of put the word in? What made you come down?
I don't know. I think we saw an ad in the paper and just liked the idea of it. Sort of heard about it from friends and came down.
Well, now you're here, madam. What do you think?
I like it because it's something different, and it's good fun, not expensive. Good night out.
And where would you be if you weren't here, do you think?
Watching the telly.
I am Joseph O'Gorman.
What's your minimum bet?
Right.
Well, I'm here at the track side with one of the bookmakers. Joe, you're meant to be the men that make all the money, aren't you?
Well, it can be up and down, but generally on the year, like all jobs, you wanna make a profit, yes. But it's not a kind of job where you get a guaranteed amount each year. You have good years, you have your bad years.
How's it going tonight so far?
I'm just in front, small. I had a losing race there, so I was winning a few quid now. Just about getting the wages at the moment.
I understand this is really in your family. Several generations have been doing just what you're doing tonight here at Walthamstow.
Yeah, my grandfather's brother was a bookmaker here. Then my father works for them. Then my father got a pitch next to them, I believe. There was a lot more bookmakers here in those days. They used to bet all the way around the track because they used to get a lot more people here then. So they whittled their business down into one, and now I've taken over from my father.
We've heard a lot of people saying that it's a lot more about entertainment now, the dogs. It's less about gambling. Do you find that's the case with you?
Well, still, as you can see, there's still plenty of gamblers here. A lot of hardcore gamblers don't particularly like the crowds here on a Saturday, find it hard to get on the tote, find it hard to get down to the bookmakers. But I think if you've got decent bars, decent arena like this, it speaks for itself. That's why you get the people here.
I suppose you must get people, it's their birthday, they're feeling lucky and they just fancy a punt.
Yep, exactly. The smaller punters tend to go on the tote, which is obviously good for the track, and we try and accommodate for the people that prefer to have a decent bet and know what odds they're taking.
So this is greyhound racing in the 21st century, but for the origins of the sport we have to go back to the 1920s. That was when the idea of dogs chasing an artificial lure, usually fashioned to look like a hare, was first developed in the United States. It quickly spread to the United Kingdom and then to Ireland, which remains the world's largest exporter of thoroughbred greyhounds. The World Greyhound Federation was founded in the late 1960s, when those nations already mentioned joined with Spain, Australia and Mexico to share the benefits of their experience. Sean Collins, the Secretary General of the World Greyhound Federation, told me the sport continues to grow.
The countries where the sport is promoted, operated and operated successfully, I would have to say to you, it's Italy, France, Finland, Sweden, Germany, Holland, Macau, San Margarita, down opposite the South American coast. Trinidad is certainly progressing their plans to launch the sport there. Guam, New Zealand, Tasmania. I could keep going.
Well, on your travels, what are some of the places you visited? Some of the stories you can tell and maybe some of the differences you've seen between the sport you've grown up with in Ireland
and the sport you've seen develop elsewhere?
The difference is, I would say that there are those who would point to greyhound racing as being less than honest, less than well run. All I would say that is a total misconception, because the people who promote greyhound racing worldwide, they are determined, and they are successful in that determination that the sport is run beyond reproach, particularly in the countries that are now emerging as greyhound racing countries. They have not been welcomed by the promoters of the other pari-mutuel betting sports, for the simple reason that it means a sharing of the betting dollar, or the betting pound, or the betting rand, or whatever. So as a consequence, I think greyhound racing had to develop from the ground up. They have to develop stadia that meet the requirements of modern day living and modern day entertainment and going out, and they have also to meet the very strict requirements that the public demand in having a sport that's upfront and honestly run and honestly promoted.
And in your dealings with some of the nations that may have come to you personally perhaps, and asked your advice, your opinion, who have you helped along the way, do you think?
I certainly have. I've helped quite a number. I've been down in South Africa, and I think that is the country that will hopefully have a massive breakthrough very shortly. There are other Asian countries that are on the verge of breaking through. Certainly, South Vietnam is a very interesting case in point, and I'm sure that there's a franchise available for Cambodia. Those are the ones. Trinidad, I would think, certainly. Another case in point, you have racing in Mexico at Caliente, and they have, I think, faced up to a very good opportunity. They have a combined horse greyhound facility, which means maximizing the use of their stadium and of their facilities, and I think is one of the ways forward.
Some of the places we've been speaking about, I suppose Macau is a former Portuguese territory, and South Africa people might say, well, there's a certain European element there, an expatriate element perhaps, that's helped to promote the sport. But in the case of somewhere like Vietnam or Korea or Trinidad, these are places that you might not expect the sport to be. How have they got to the point where it is there or it's going to be there?
I think they have television and particularly the satellite transmission of live greyhound racing from one part of the world to the other. In fact, I think just to quote you an example, that in recent times, live greyhound racing television pictures were sent via satellite from the west coast of Florida into Moscow with a Russian commentary. Now, if that's not progress, I don't know what it is. We have the advent now of satellite racing and internet betting, and I think that there's a growing realization that it's a sport that is, it's a very pleasant, enjoyable evening out and evening's entertainment, not expensive to own a greyhound on the same line of expenses as race horses. The tracks are reasonably accessible. They're at a time when people have leisure time, and by and large, those people that the thrill of winning, and particularly in an Irish situation, the thrill of rearing your own greyhound and racing him is one not to be passed up.
Is going to a greyhound meeting, a greyhound race meeting in the Caribbean or in Africa or in Asia, is it the same as going to one in Europe or North America? Or do you think particular countries that you can think of add something of their own culture to the evening?
I think they do, particularly, say, in Dubai, where, as of now, betting on horse racing or greyhound racing is not permitted because of local situations. But the way the Emiratians enjoy their racing, as we seem to be believed, that you can get thousands who flock to the Nad al-Sheba horse track in Dubai, and they also flock, and they're hundreds, which you can have 1,500, 2,000 people at a Greyhound meeting 150 kilometres down the way in Aileen without any betting. But they enjoy it, and it's a big family occasion. And I must say that of any country I've been in, the way the attendees at those, at particularly at Greyhound Racing in Aileen, enjoy their sport is something to be seen and witnessed. Asia looks the best prospects for a very substantial expansion of Greyhound Racing down there, because the Asians are very keen gamblers, very keen bettors, and I think Greyhound Racing is a ready-made sport for them, and one that they will, I think, will grasp if they get the necessary government support to put the infrastructure in situ.
As Sean said, success comes with investment in regulation. For some, the Irish system is a benchmark of how it should be done. With a government-appointed state agency in charge, attendances have almost doubled in 5 years. Michael Field is the chief executive of the Irish board. A former school teacher, he began by giving me a history lesson. It seems that when it comes to their high regard for the greyhound, the Irish have a lot in common with the ancient Egyptians.
Well, the greyhounds, they're etched out on the on the pyramids, and very, very often when you see the chieftains of that time, they had the greyhounds with them. And the greyhound has had a great history. I suppose there are different derivations of greyhounds down over the centuries, but they've always been associated with royalty. But in Ireland, they've been associated with the very ordinary people. And they have provided an income in leaner years. We're in a great economy in Ireland now, but back after the war in Ireland, many people reared greyhounds in their backyards, in towns, and in country villages. They bred the best greyhounds in the world. He was much appreciated and much cared for in the Irish rural atmosphere.
Well, this strikes me as an unprecedented boom time for the sport within Ireland. Mm. Now, part of that continued success, I would imagine, is what may be called a consumer confidence or a belief in the sport. How can you reassure people that there isn't doping in the sport of greyhound racing, or if there is, you're doing your very best to stamp it out?
We have a very stringent regulations, first of all, and we have set up our own laboratory, which has met the highest standards, the highest European standards, and we have stewards attending meetings every night. Every night that there's a greyhound race meeting, we have an official steward present there, and we have the other staff, then the managers and things, but we have a specific steward, and the onus is on him then to do random checks, and we have a kind of a flying squad that visit tracks on a random basis. So while you'll never be able to guarantee people 100% that you can eradicate all these things, we have a process in place that gives us confidence, and I hope gives our customers confidence that we're making a fair shot at it.
And the other area of ensuring confidence is the issue of animal welfare. Again, on that score, what measures does your organisation put in place and adhere to make sure everything is above board in that respect?
Many of the greyhounds reared in this country, some of them are kept for breeding, many of them are exported, and there is need. Some people are less scrupulous than others, you know, in every walk of life you find that, and we are monitoring that greyhounds, when they're finished their racing, are properly cared for. We have an adoption programme, we fund that very generously, and we will continue to monitor that and to encourage people. At home in our own house, we'd have greyhounds that would be 8, 9 and 10 years old, dawdling around the place, some of them breeding, some of them not. And that's quite a pattern in Ireland, because of the fact that it's much of it, the rearing and breeding is rural-based. And rural-based people don't mind a few extra dogs around the place at all. But we also have the programme in place for picking up the dogs after racing, and we're trying to encourage people. Other countries are ahead of us in this. Maybe America is very, very forward in it, and I was in Australia, and they're quite good at it as well. And we're working on it now, and I think we'll do a good job in making people aware of the necessity to look after the dogs that we all love and that give so much pleasure to many of us.
Who let the dogs out?
Up here in the paddock with Jim Reynolds, one of the trainers. Now, Jim, first of all, why is it that the greyhound dog is so suited to running?
The racing greyhound races naturally from the beginning of time. It's the oldest purebred animal in the world, from the beginning of the time. They've actually naturally hunted. The Egyptians used them in the deserts. It's just they've taken what the greyhound is naturally good at and processed it to racing on a track.
And as you bring up your dogs, what do you look for? What are the signs when you know you've got a dog that could be a champion for you?
There are a lot of things that a greyhound needs to be a good dog. They're like any kind of athlete. They need to have the build, they need to have the physique, they need to have the temperament. It's very, very important for them. So it's small pieces of everything that makes a dog very, very good.
Give us an idea of the average career length of a dog and what you'd expect out of one of yours.
The racing greyhounds are reared till 12 or 15 months as puppies. They're taken from 12 or 15 months and they are schooled to actually physically race around the track and race after the lure. They start their racing career from 15 months onwards. They can race anywhere up to 6, 7, sometimes even 8 years old. What dictates the length of the career is how they actually run for the racing career, and provided they stay free from injury.
As a trainer, is this the place to train and race your dogs in Britain, or are there other areas where it's more lucrative or more attractive, perhaps?
The breeding and the home of greyhound racing just now is Ireland. That's where the majority of dogs are bred. The racing in Ireland, the economy in Ireland is very, very buoyant just now, so racing in Ireland is very buoyant. There is a lot of money in Ireland. I think probably Australia is a country that leads the world just now with regards to the rearing of greyhounds, to the racing of greyhounds, and to the care of greyhounds. They have the veterinary backup, they have the feeding system in place. America follows suit as well, but Britain are one of the front runners.
And is it something that as a trainer you can make a living from? Is this what you do for a living?
I do for a living, yes. I'm up at 5:45 every morning and get to bed at 12 o'clock every evening, 7 days a week, every day of the year, Christmas Day, New Year's Day. Unfortunately, when you're working with animals, you've got to accept that it is a full-time job and that you've got to work every day. People are shocked to come down to our kennels and see what we actually do for the racing greyhound. We clean their teeth every day, we clean their ears every day, the dogs are massaged, their nails are clipped every day, their nails are filed every day. The things that we do for the care, as I said before, the greyhound is not a dog, the greyhound is an athlete, and we have got to treat them accordingly with a proper diet, a proper training routine, and a regular routine.
We go to the dog track on Saturday night. We put all our money on a dog that we like. A kiss and a cuddle, an awfully high. $2 tickets and a starry sky.
It's approaching midnight here at Walthamstow. The crowds have gone home, and it's the first time the bar and restaurant have been empty all evening. The bookmakers are counting their money, and a few are licking their wounds. The trainers and their greyhounds, the athletes we all came to see, they're leaving too. Walthamstow Dogs is among the oldest tracks in the world, and it's certainly one of the most well-known. But I wonder how many of tonight's crowd know about the World Greyhound Federation, and whether they realise that people just like them are enjoying the sport right around the globe. Going to the dogs has never been so popular.
Me wage packet, I read it. And I'll put 25 nicker, please, on yellow printer. Oh, I hope the wife don't find out. Yes, it's short a wheel, isn't it? Yes, I know, it's a good dog. I saw it run at White City just last week. Broke the record.
Quite a program, wasn't it? Sports International went to the dogs. At this time tomorrow, One Planet here on the BBC World Service, and on Friday it's time for Discovery. A few days ago, towards the end of the day's trading, the share index at London Stock Exchange took a sudden nosedive. Next morning, share prices recovered and rumours started circulating that the unexpected plunge was due to a simple typing error.